Well, good morning, church. Will you rise and sing with us this morning? So we think about God's amazing grace in your life, all the things he's done for you, all the ways he's taken care of you when we didn't deserve it. Will you sing along with us?
Stronger, the King.
Good morning, church. My name's Adam. I'm one of the pastors here. It's so good to be with you this morning, singing praises to our King. I have a few announcements this morning that I want to draw your attention to. The first is that Guy and Sarah Cox have been posted up on the wall in the hallway in the entryway for membership. And so they're interested in becoming members of ERCC. And if you have any questions or anything about what that means, we'd love for you to catch Pastor Jeremy after the service today if you are interested in membership. But Guy and Sarah will be posted for the next week till Easter. And then they will be kind of inaugurated into our church. So we're excited to have them as members and looking forward to that. If you have any questions, though, about them or the process, feel free to reach out to Pastor Jeremy or one of the elders. Also, this week we have Senior Bible Fellowship. They meet on Tuesday at 11:30 in the media room. They do a delicious lunch. Carrier plays ukulele. They do worship and study the word, and it's really a great time for seniors. So if you are interested in that or know somebody, please feel free to bring them, invite them, help them to feel welcome here in our church. And if anyone needs a ride, please feel free to contact a Dean or Carrier for that. Also, this coming week, we have our Easter Spring Fling. This is a huge event that our church puts together for the community and for our church, for families, for young kids, to just get an opportunity to come and see what our church is like, get to know us a little bit. So we're going to have an egg hunt. We're going to have games and prizes and all that next week from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. So I would encourage you to invite your friends and neighbors to come to this. Also, we still have a few needs for helping out, especially beforehand, to set up. So if you have an interest in that or some availability Thursday, Friday, or Saturday, we'd love your help to come and get set up for that event. You can see Kristen or Jan in the lobby after service following today if you are interested in helping out. We're also going to be holding a ministry fair. This is going to be in April. This is a way for you to get to know the different ministries going on in our church and also the different missions that we support. And so I invite you to come on out to that. We're going to have an ice cream social and just a time of gathering, getting to know how you can get more involved in ERCC. In the back of your chairs, there's a connection card. If you're new with us today or you just need to get connected, send a prayer request, I invite you to fill that card out and turn it into one of the black boxes around the sanctuary or hand it to one of our greeters. We'd love to kind of get to know you better or pray for you too. I'm going to invite Pastor Jeremy up. He's got a good word here about our Passion Week and Good Friday service. So,
good morning, church. Happy Palm Sunday. This Sunday marks the beginning of what is known as Holy Week, or also known as Passion Week. And this is the week in which Jesus enters into Jerusalem so that he could be crucified. He knew, knowing full well that he was going to be led to the cross as the penalty for our sins, he spent the week doing ministry in the city of Jerusalem. And what we do every year is we do have morning devotionals starting at 8 o'clock. We bumped the time. It was really early, and now we bumped it to 8 simply because it is a time in the morning to gather before work, before that time to gather and have a short time of worship and a devotional led by myself. But what we'll do is we'll gather and we'll pray. We will go into God's word and prepare our hearts for this week. If you are unable to join us on Monday through Thursday for these morning devotionals, I highly encourage you to take a moment before your busy day starts, before your week starts, to go into the Word. On our website, we do have a devotional series for this upcoming week that should lead you through various scriptures to read and just to reflect on as you go through this week. But really, the idea as we enter into this Passion Week, we are preparing ourselves to walk alongside Christ as he prepares himself to be crucified. And so on Good Friday, this upcoming Friday at 6:30, we will be meeting here in the sanctuary for a service. And just to give you some understanding of what that Good Friday service is going to look like, it is a time to come with a somber heart. It is a time to come with a reflective heart as we come to worship our Lord. Good Friday is highly crucial for us to come and gather to worship worship Christ in this more reflective posture, because as we focus on Good Friday and what Jesus did on the cross for us, we are essentially preparing ourselves for Sunday, for the resurrection. As we understand the depths of our sin on Friday, and as we even go on with our lives on Saturday with our spring fling and having the neighbors and having the community come and enjoy just being together, it is all in preparation for Easter Sunday, where we come and we gather and we celebrate the true reason of why we gather, which is the resurrection of Christ. And so this is a busy week, I understand, but if you have the opportunity, would you join us in this week in a time of devotional as well as service? At this time, I do want to lead us in worship, in continuation of our worship, with the giving of our tithes and our offerings. This is in no means a way to obligate you. Please feel no compulsion to give. There's nothing the church wants from you. This is a time for us to commune with our Lord and for us to talk to God with our resources, saying to the Lord that this is our small act of worship unto Him. And so as we have boxes on the side as well as on our website for giving, again, feel no obligation to give, but would you join with me in a time of prayer, a time of reflection for the Lord? Thank you.
This time we're going to dismiss our kids to kids' church. So teachers and kids, you guys can head on out. I'm going to read the scripture. This morning, Pastor Jeremy is going to be speaking from the book of Matthew, chapter 21, on Jesus' triumphal entry this Palm Sunday. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them at once." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, 'Behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." Will you pray with me? Father, we pray for your word to penetrate our hearts. Lord, and out of an overflowing of your love, may we understand our purpose in this life, the desires you have for us, and what you want to teach us today as Pastor Jeremy brings a word. Father, I pray for Pastor Jeremy as he instructs us through using scripture, as we get wisdom, as we get understanding of who you are and our place with you and our relationship with you, God. Pray that you would give PJ strength and a boldness to speak the truth in love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church. It is a happy Palm Sunday. Hopefully we get this worked out. We're going to try and see if I can control the slides from my iPad now. Don't know if it's working. I'm not. Okay, we'll figure this out. I'm sorry about technical difficulties on my end, trying to be better at this. Anyways, okay. I apologize. So when coming into Palm Sunday, as we talk about Jesus entering into to Jerusalem to be crucified, what I always start off with every year, and it's essentially the same passage, the same story every year, and I always find it so interesting, is that these people who are ushering in Jesus into the city, they're saying, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is this one who is David." And I always think about their perspective and how they are trying to define what a Messiah is and what Jesus is going to do. And these people, as they are worshiping him, not anything against them, but the way they view the Messiah is as this king figure, someone who is going to bring about revolution, that Jesus is going to come in and he's going to overthrow the government. He is going to overthrow the Roman Empire. He's going to overthrow the human structure of all things. And again, I've in the past, I've blamed these people and being like, they don't know what they're doing. Like, they don't know that they're welcoming Jesus into the city, but they have all of these wrong expectations. They have all of these wrong concepts and ideas regarding who Jesus is. I'm gonna start this off by saying I am not here to condemn these people as they lay down these palm branches and they say, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." I think that they are doing what they are supposed to be doing. They are welcoming Jesus in and saying, "You are the Messiah, you are the King." There is nothing wrong with that. If anything, they are doing a good thing. That as Jesus is walking into Jerusalem, that they are saying, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. This man, he is the Messiah. He is the King." The issue, the real issue is, and we don't know, the text doesn't say, is what those people were doing the subsequent week. That as they enter into this Passion Week, what were their conversations? And I can just guess what these people's conversation were after they have Palm Sunday and they lay down the branches and Jesus enters in by a donkey, and the disciples are following close behind, and they're thinking this is like a military parade, like a military procession where the new governor, the new king is entering into the city. And I'm sure the people were thinking, all right, this is the time. This is us. And so kids, pack your bags because we're going to move to a better house. We're going to overthrow the governor. We're going to overthrow all these things. And so make sure you prepare yourself, because this week things are going to go down. This is the week. And again, I don't think the people who are worshiping Jesus, saying, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," I don't think they were wrong in preparing for things to go down. I don't think they were wrong for preparing for something dramatic to happen. But their expectations were something incredible is going to happen. And this is the thing. We know something incredible does happen. But what happens completely goes against their understanding of what is right. And I have to start this by explaining where I'm going with this. I don't know about you, but for me, watching baseball is something I've had to learn how to do. When I was a kid, when my dad or someone would turn on a baseball game, it's almost like, oh gosh, like that's the most boring sport ever. Like, it's just so uninteresting to me. And as a child, I would watch it and just be like, I don't care. It's just a bunch of guys standing around. And even when you play, you're just like, oh, it's so boring. But hold on, before you burn me at the stake. What has made baseball very interesting, I don't watch it regularly, but when I watch it, what's very interesting is when you learn that pitchers pitch differently. And maybe this is so rudimentary and so elementary for you, but for me, I just assumed that when a pitcher pitched, it's just fast and straight, and it's either a strike or a ball. And thankfully, when you watch the TV, it has that box, and like you can even see, oh, it went in the box, strike. It went out the box, ball. I thought it was as simple as that. But when you get into watching baseball, you realize like what makes it fun is it's the battle between the batter and the pitcher. And you would think, okay, the battle is that the pitcher's going to throw it as fast as he can, and the batter has to keep up with it. No, not at all. If anything, if the batter knows that it's a fastball, and the batter knows that this pitcher throws a fastball, well, he's going to time it really well. He'll know as soon as the pitcher winds up, he'll say, okay, it's coming down, it's going to come on the inside, on the outside. Like, he'll know, and he'll be able to time his swing, and he'll be able to hit it out of the park. But the issue is that pitchers have different kinds of pitches. A good pitcher may have 3, 4, some even have 5 different kinds of pitches. And so for just a normal vernacular, you have the fastball, which is just fast and straight, and hopefully it's a strike. Or you have something called a curveball. I mean, there are tons of pitches, but I'm sure you've heard of a curveball. And a curveball is interesting because it's not as fast as a fastball. It's a change of pace. And so again, if the pitcher is just throwing fastballs, it's hard to pitch because it's fast. But the thing is that if you time it well, then they can really hit those out of the park. And so when a pitcher adds in a curveball, first off, there are different kinds of curveballs, and there are different kinds of spin that you have. It freaks out the batter. And maybe, again, you're like, it doesn't freak them out. No, sometimes you see batters freak out. When it's, again, right-handed pitcher, left-handed pitcher, baseball is very complicated. But the ball, it spins, and it creates a curve. And again, I don't play baseball, but if you've ever gone to a batting cage, sometimes you realize how crazy the major leagues are with how fast these curve balls are going. They're going at like 80, 90 miles an hour, and it's curving towards you. I am not a baseball person, but I can imagine if I'm hitting and a ball is curving towards me at 80 miles an hour, at 90 miles an hour, and it's, okay, the way the ball is going, it's not straight, because straight, okay, I can make sure that goes by me, but if a ball is coming at me at that speed, I don't know about you, but if that was happening to me where a curveball is coming and it's about to hit me, I'm not going to swing, I'm going to run. I'm going to go away. And again, if you are like, nah, I see it on the TV, it's not that bad. No, trust me. Just go to a batting cage and go to like the 70 mile per hour, the ranges. You'll see you won't be so confident. It's terrifying. Why do I bring this up? In baseball, if you know what the pitcher is going to pitch, the game's easy.
I dislike the Houston Astros. I don't know. I'm from Texas. I really don't like them. But the Houston Astros were notorious because they won championships because they cheated. They knew what the pitcher was going to throw, and they were so bad at it, but they would bang a trash can to let the batters know what pitch was coming. Drives me crazy because it's blatant cheating that you can hear the videos and you can see that they're cheating and you can hear they're cheating because the batters know what the pitch is coming, and so they're able to you know wait for their pitch because I know I'm waiting for a certain pitch and I know I can hit those really hard. I bring this up because this Jesus in his ministry was telling his disciples, this is what's going to happen. I am going to be crucified. And you know what the disciples did with that information? They didn't think to themselves, oh, thank you, Jesus, for giving us the game plan. Thank you for letting us know what's going to happen and so we can hit those out of the park. No, what they're saying is, no, that can't happen. And just, if I can leave you with an image, just for you to understand, is that God will throw you curveballs. God will, in your life, throw you curveballs, but he's not a malicious God. He's not throwing you a curveball because he wants you to fail. He wants to throw you a curveball to teach you to trust him more. If I can leave you with anything in this message and anything about Palm Sunday that is so important, is that God, in many ways, will throw you fastballs. He'll throw you just easy balls straight down the middle where you will be like the people on Palm Sunday where it's like, this is a fastball. Jesus coming in on a donkey, you know, we know the scriptures. We know this is prophesied about the Messiah, that he's going to enter into Jerusalem on a donkey. That is down in the middle. If anything, it's not even that fast. It's just perfect. And it's just boom. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Welcome into Jerusalem, our Messiah and our King. And we just love hitting those out of the park. And we're just like, wow, look at how far that goes. We see Jesus. But you see, the disciples were on that next phase, that next level, where Jesus would say, okay, yes, I am the Messiah, but the Messiah is going to die. He is going to be on the cross. I am going to die, and I'm going to raise again 3 days later. But I'm giving you this information. I am telling you my pitch. I am going to do this. This is going to happen. And the disciples were like, Peter, so much so, he literally struck out. Meaning that Jesus told him, Peter, you are going to deny me 3 times. And Peter's like, whoa, Lord, time out. There's no way that's going to happen. Because if I'm in that situation and I'm in the batter's box and they question me and they throw those pitches at me, I'm just going to hit it out of the park. And what we see Peter do is he does deny Jesus 3 times. Jesus is doing something in his ministry. And he's explaining, and it's our first point for today, is that God defies our expectations. You see, God's first point of why he throws you curveballs. And I'm really adamant that being a Christian is not as straightforward as people make it to be. That there are so many curveballs that God throws at you, that God puts in your way, that it looks, again, just imagine a curveball coming at you and it's turning towards your face and you're like, how in the world it's going to hit me? It's going to, like, I'm just terrified of this curveball that's going to hit me in the face. But the thing is this, God is not throwing these curveballs at you to actually hit you. He's doing it because he wants you to understand that this is something that is possible, and it's something that if you know how to recognize it and to trust his voice, that it's actually the best kind of pitch. Because when you know it's coming, it's slower. If you know the curve, then really when you get your weight behind it, you can hit those curveballs out of the park. But see, many times when we deal with our relationship with God, we are the ones to tell God, no, God, no more curveballs. Only fastballs. And don't even make them too fast. Make them just like lofted little dinkers over, so I can hit those. And you know the funny thing is, if you are spiritually immature, and I'm not here to even call you spiritually immature. If you're spiritually immature, this may be what your relationship with God is like, where you're just like, hey, God, slow it down. You know, I want to worship you, but make sure you just kind of loft those pitches, and then I'll hit those. I think God is gracious to us. I'm not here to judge anyone. If that's where you're at in your relationship with him, great. Wonderful. I'm not here to judge you. Continue to ask God for those small pitches. But you see what Jesus is doing with his disciples in this process is he is taking them to the next level of their spiritual maturity, where he is explaining things are not going to work out the way you think they're going to work out. I think for us, in our day and age, this really begins by understanding that God is higher than us. I think we live in such a technologically advanced age. We live in one with the internet, with artificial intelligence, with just millions and billions of people who are constantly connected to one another, that we actually think to ourselves, we as a species, as the human species, we're pretty smart. We can do a lot, and the ingenuity of man is pretty great. Look at what the corporations and the tech companies can accomplish. But you see, I think the beauty of being a Christian is learning that God's ways are higher than our ways. That sometimes we are just thinking, this is how it has to be. And God constantly reminds his people that sometimes the best way isn't as straightforward as you think. That the best way is for the Son of God to be crucified on a cross. The best way is for you to... for you to be alone for those 3 days as you've seen your Savior dying on a cross, that you have to wait for 3 days for his resurrection. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8 and 9 says this, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher," if we can put it on the screen, "for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts, your thoughts." I think this is a very important passage that curveballs in our life, where God throws things at us that don't really make sense. Let's just be real. If you are walking in a season of life where things don't go according to your plan, according to what you would deem good, understand that God does this very intentionally to show you, to remind you, not that he wants to hurt you, to remind you that he has a better ability, he has a better skill set to control the universe than you do. I think as I meet people, and even with myself, we have an obsession with control. We have an obsession with being able to manage our little world in our little box. And again, this is where many of us learn how to make those boxes bigger and our worlds bigger with our relationships and our friendships. And we love to be able to control or predict or understand, you know, what people are going to do or what we are able to do, how we're able to have fun and enjoy life. But we love to have that kind of control. We love that organization. We love the ability to know that things have their own place. And we have this paradigm where we are the masters of our world. And I don't, again, I'm not trying to judge you. I am the same way. But what God does in many times is he sees you being sovereign, you being ruler over your life, over everything you're doing, that you are in control, and he throws a curveball at you. He throws a curveball at you so that as you are saying, I'm in control, that curveball is coming your way, and then you realize, I am not in control. I am in deep trouble. What do I do? I can't manage this and have this curveball coming my way. How in the world am I supposed to manage this? This can't be good. This is bad. This is terrible. How can I keep all of these plates spinning? How can I juggle all of these responsibilities? And God adds another curveball my way. This is not good. You see, Isaiah is talking here to the people of Israel saying, no, God's ways are higher than your ways. The reason why this is so stressful on you is because you are understanding it only from your perspective. But remember, the God you worship, the God you serve, is the God of the universe. To go even further on this line, it's the next slide. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27 through 29, "But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human might boast in the presence of God." What I love about this is that Paul gets right to it. God uses the foolish. I mean, again, this concept does not go well with our human sensibilities. If you are going to try to teach something of wisdom, you will use something wise. We love doing this. We think to ourselves, who should I learn from? You know, like, if you're going to learn from someone, wouldn't you want to learn from the guy wearing the suit, the guy who's able to talk eloquently, the guy who is well-studied and well-versed, that his resume explains that he is an expert in this field for 30 years, and he has gone to lecture series, he's written 10 books, and he's done all these amazing things. Like, we're like, yeah, that's the one that is supposed to bear the wisdom of the world. They're the gurus, they're the ones who know it all. And again, I don't think there's a flaw in that logic. I think that logic actually makes a lot of sense. Who are you going to trust? Who are you going to trust with expertise? The experts, right? You want to trust the ones, again, if I'm trying to build a house, you don't want to trust me. I know nothing about building a home. I know nothing about construction. You want to find someone who's good in construction. You want to find someone who's done it for a long time. But you see, this is where our human logic fails many times, because this is all about human planning. In human planning, what do? You find the ones who are wise. But what Paul is explaining in 1 Corinthians is that God loves to use the foolish. That if anything, God's purpose is less about having the ones qualified. He uses the weak. He uses the ones who aren't that strong. And the reason is because God loves to show his strength. He loves to show how good and powerful and amazing he is. And so when he uses weaker vessels, it shows to every human, to every all of creation, this wasn't the working of man, because man was only able to do what they are able to do. But this is a miracle. This is God doing something beyond our own ways, beyond our own understanding. And so God purposely uses the foolish to show that his ways are higher than our own, that his plans exceed our own, that God isn't... He's not playing the same game that you and I are. He's not playing the same game, this rat race that we're all trying to run. That God is outside of it all, and he's just trying to love you. He's trying to open your eyes, and we are so caught up. We're so caught up in what our own plans are. Again, like I'm saying, going back to Palm Sunday, going back to this idea that the people are praising Jesus, and I think that's absolutely beautiful. I think it's wonderful that they're laying down palms for Jesus to enter into the city. But the creeping assumption I have is, as the week goes on, they're thinking, how does this benefit me? How does the Messiah coming into the city of Jerusalem benefit numero uno? How do I gain wealth? How do I gain power? How do I gain prestige from the Messiah coming in? I better get close to him. I better be near him so that I can be in good graces with the Messiah. So when he takes over all, I can be close to the Master. You see, the beauty is that the answer to that question of prosperity should be answered. That the week does end with the prosperity of humans. The gospel message is a message of prosperity. It is about, you do get something out of this.
That God's plan for you is not one to destroy you. God's plan for you is for you to live a life of prosperity, a life full, a life completely endowed with joy and happiness and hope and peace. But you see, it goes completely against your expectations. Because as we come up with the idea of Jesus entering into our lives, we begin to dream sinful dreams. We begin to make plans that are not his ways, that are not his plans. So you see, that's where this Western prosperity gospel begins to deviate from Scripture. Is that the prosperity gospel will tell you, your plans are good plans. And this is what always drives me crazy. The prosperity gospel is saying, those dreams you have, they're from God. God is the one who put those desires in you. And so if God placed those desires in you, then it must be a part of his plan for your desires to be fulfilled. What I really irks me is that it's such a half-truth. Because your desires, your motivations in life are given to you by God. 100%. And I'm not going to stray away from that. In many ways, I agree with prosperity gospel preachers that say that your desires are from God. But here is the big pivots. The prosperity gospel will say you have desires in your hearts. And if you worship Jesus, then he will give you the desires of your heart. There's a beautiful twist that comes with this. You have your desires and you need to kill yourself. You need to die to yourself. You need to lay down your desires at the feet of Jesus. You need to die to oneself, lay down your desires, and you begin to see that your plan, your desires, are not in comparison to the desires of God's heart for you. And when God then shows you his desire for you, you realize, oh, those were my initial desires. You wanted me to live my life to the fullest. You wanted me to enjoy relationship with others. But the way that I was doing it, my plan of how I can get those desires, was not the way you wanted me to. To use this really, really quickly, Romans chapter 8 is one of my favorite chapters of Romans. Verse 26 starts like this. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Before I move on to the next section in verse 28, I do want to talk about intercession of the Spirit and how God even leads us in our own prayers. You see, many times I think when we think about prayer, we think, okay, here's my laundry list of all the things that I want from God. This, again, goes way back. This goes back to desires, your plan, your logic. And I'm guilty of this as well. This is why I love preaching to you. It's because I'm really just talking to myself. When I pray, it's like, God, here's bullet point one, bullet point two, bullet point three, bullet point four. Please address all of the above. See attached. You know, I've BCC'd all of my friends and family. And we kind of just post our prayer requests in that way. Like, these are my requests. God, you be like my assistant and just deal with these things. I think what I love about Romans 8 is basically saying, like, Romans 8, 26 is saying, like, do you guys get that what you're doing here is disrespectful? Like, do you get that even the way you're praying is arrogant? Like, okay, I'm not meaning to make fun of you guys, but you're talking to God, the king of the universe, the one who made everything, and you are bringing to him, you're bringing to him your little qualms and your issues and your problems. You kind of get where you're making this whole world centered around you and your problems? And okay, this is where people are like, okay, so I shouldn't pray at all. I mean, God doesn't care then about my itty-bitty problems, my insignificant life and all of my worries and my fears. No. Don't get me wrong. It's great for you to pray. I'm just, I'm just here to say, don't you understand that it's a little selfish? That when you pray, you're first thinking, what prayer request do I have? The beauty of being a Christian is that you are covered by the blood of Jesus. You are deemed righteous, and you have the Holy Spirit to be with you. And there is a way in which we talk to God, understanding that even when we pray, that we are weak, that we are in our weaknesses, and we need God to pray for us. This is perhaps one of the most freeing things about being a Christian, is understanding, yeah, the way I pray is not right. I need even the power of God to pray correctly. And so, God, I'm dealing with all of these issues, and I'm giving it to you. Will you help me pray through these things? Because my logic, my plans, my will, and my desires is even getting in the way of my prayer. And the beauty of this is Paul's explaining, yeah, the Spirit loves to do that. The Spirit loves to walk alongside you and pray with a groaning too deep for words. We don't pray as we ought. Romans 8:28 says this, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. Before we get into a conversation about Calvinism and Arminianism, this passage is so important, not because it's talking about election and predestination. This is so important in our understanding that when we have our requests and our prayers and our weaknesses, that we serve a God who already knows, who already has it solved, who can orchestrate all things to work for good and not for evil. And the beauty is, you don't know how he's going to do it, but you trust that he's going to. See, this is the beauty of this prayer that we're talking about, learning to trust God, learning to go to him in the unexpected of life. That our call is to trust God in all things unexpected. And the way that we go about this, is by praying in the Spirit. It's by understanding that even when we pray, that our abilities are so limited. When I say our abilities are so limited, I mean just that. You and I have no ability to turn all things for good. I really want you to take this to heart. You're not a bad person. You're not terrible. You're not horrible. But you have no ability to make something bad and turn it to something good. You can try all you want. You can work your whole life. You can try to bring up all the solutions, but you simply do not have the power to turn something bad into something good. And this is where people will be like, but what about all the advancements in technology? What about all the things that human progress can bring? And I want to just let you know, none of that is actually going to end up being good. It's going to bring about more pain. It's going to bring about more war, more suffering, more economic imbalance. It's going to lead to more injustice. And this is where we need to understand that as a human species, that as humanity progresses and goes forward, you see, as we experience more progress, we begin to become haughty and begin to become prideful, thinking, oh, we have the best technology. We have the most money. We have the most ability. We can do it. I need to remind you of the story of the Tower of Babel and how pertinent it is for our day and age. The story of the Tower of Babel is a fascinating one in which the people of the time believed that they could build this structure called the Tower of Babel that could reach God. And it wasn't this idea that they were building a space elevator and they were going up to the heavens. It was this idea that they would build a religious building that would be able to suffice for the magnificent powers of God, where they could look at the tower and say, we are in no need of God. We have this tower.
We have this ability to see all of the problems of the world from our tower. We're able to govern over ourselves. We are in no need of God. The Tower of Babel is one in which God sees that. He sees the arrogance of man, thinking that they have this ability through their technology to reach the heights of God. And what God does is he disperses them across the world, and he confuses their language so they don't have this kind of harmony and this kind of ability to gather together, to have no need for him. But the way that I interpret this story is not that God is like threatened by these people. God is like, oh, goodness. Their tower is really amazing and magnificent. They're able to do what I was not able to do. So I got to spread them apart, confuse them a little bit, and that's going to solve all the world's problems. No. You see, as God is doing that, he's doing it as a grace unto them and trying to show them you cannot replace God. You cannot replace the work of God that you... You need to learn this on your own. You need to learn that your technology, that your government, your society, that the ways of man are not as good as the ways of God. I really want to hammer this point home, that as we grow in our trusting, as we grow in our trust of God over the unexpected, As we do this, this is the vision series. And it kind of ends here. It more, if anything, ends next Sunday as we talk about the resurrection. But the vision series is all about this, that we are gathered as a community to love others and to love God. I hope this was really clear through this whole series, is that it all comes back to love. It all comes back to loving one another. It all comes back to relationships with others and with God. But there is a key point to this whole thing, is that if you think you can do this vision, this mission, without God, without his power, without his ability, without his ruling and his reigning, you are as guilty as those who built the Tower of Babel. You see, I really want to hammer this home because of the society we live in today. The culture we live in today is looking to the structures, the man-made instruments that we've built. And I think the internet comes to mind as this ubiquitous solution to all of the world's problems. Because if we can be interconnected to people around the world at all times, don't you think that humanity is going to come together and we will be able to make this utopia and make things all things right and agree on everything? I hope you get that I am being a little sarcastic. That when we create these amazing, amazing structures and amazing things that we say, wow, look at what humanity is able to create, that our sinful nature ruins it, because at the core of who we are selfish, and we desire what we want. We desire our path. We desire our way, and our way to our perspective is straight. Straight as an arrow. It's down the middle. It is a fastball, and it makes sense to us. And you know the thing is? I'm not here to argue against your logic. I'm really not here to argue that you do see things correctly. You see things straight. And in many ways, we love to argue with one another using the Bible, using the Word of God, using Scripture to say, you see, my way is the perfect down the middle way. It is the way that just goes and just right down the middle, perfect strike. I got right in the zone. I got right in the middle, and I'm just good. I'm right, and the Bible says I'm right. Perfect. Okay, hold on. Wait a second. Wait a minute. Like, hold your horses with this ideology that you gotta be right. The call of the church is to be on our knees. And understand that even when I say I'm right, I know I'm wrong. And it's not that my content's wrong. My content, in many ways, because it's based on Scripture, I am right.
I understand this. Like, I've read the Bible numerous times. I go over the major passages. I read theological books. I know what's right and what's wrong. And I've come to this conclusion that it doesn't matter how right I am, if I'm not operating by the Spirit, if I'm not operating in love, if I'm not operating in compassion and kindness, in gentleness, in humility, then everything I do is wrong. You see, I think there is a beauty to this, is that as we're given this opportunity to be at bat, and God puts you in that position, and you're like, I got this. I know what I'm supposed to do, that God is going to throw me that fastball right down the middle, and I've read my Bible, I've practiced really hard, I know how to share the gospel, and he's going to throw that fastball straight down the middle, and I'm ready, God, I'm ready for it. You've trained me. I know that when a fastball comes, I just swing and I'm going to hit it. And I can love those people. And you see, this is how the church operates a lot of times. Is that who are you called to love? I'll love the person who comes into church with their beautiful family. And, you know, we get along really well. And I'll talk to them about Jesus because I already know that they know about Jesus. And they come in and it's like, oh, welcome. Let's talk about Christ. Oh, you love Jesus. I love this. And for a lot of us, that's that fastball coming down. And hopefully you swing and hopefully you hit it. But my concern is this. There are those curveballs. There are those curveballs, the knuckleballs. The ones that kind of float and kind of go crazy. And you're like, whoa, 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 whoa. God, I don't know how to talk to this person. How the heck am I supposed to do this? What am I supposed to do? You see, the answer is a simple one. You love them. Just love them. Be their friend. Walk with them. Trust me. Trust that I'm going to do all of this for your good. And just love them. You see, this is the vision of the church. Like, this is what I've been harping on us to love God and love others, to go out and to do this. But I think there's an expectation in us. It's like, okay, God, just throw those fastballs, and as ERCC, we'll be ready to hit it out of the park. And I'm just thinking to myself, as we're on this Palm Sunday, too many times we're like thinking that God's plan has to fit my narrative. It has to fit my logic. I think the joy of being your pastor and the church that we're in is that God's going to throw a lot of these curveballs at our church. And the question I have is, are we going to be scared when that curveball comes? Are we going to be like, oh, I'm not ready for this. I can't handle this. I can't do this because it's too curvy. It's too spirally. It's a sinker. Or it's not what I'm used to. Proverbs 3, verse 5 through 6 says this. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. This is hopefully a more famous verse for you, but as I read this, and I'll read it again. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. I think there's a beauty to this this passage. And I'm sad it's not on the screen. The idea is this. Is when you trust in God and you're at bat, you trust in him. You are in a posture of prayer. You're in a posture where you're on your knees. You're in a posture where you're saying, Lord, I know I'm at bat, but I have no idea what I'm doing. And God then has the opportunity to whisper into your ear and say, my good and faithful servant, don't worry. Don't be so afraid. I got you. This next ball that's coming, it's a curveball. And it's coming in hot, but it's going to be great. It's going to be wonderful. Okay, trust in the Lord with all your hearts. Lean on my not my own understanding, and that curveball comes, and it's coming straight for you. Leaning not on your understanding is understanding, okay, God's ways are higher than my ways. I, in my own logic, know that this ball is going to hit me, it's going to hurt me, it's going to leave a big bruise, but I'm going to trust that you said that this is going to work out, okay? And as that curveball comes, and you, in faith, swing,
You say, Lord, He'll make your path straight. He's the one who's going to make it as if it was just down the middle and that fastball that you can just hit. Joshua verse 1, or chapter 1, verse 9 says this, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." I love this verse because this is talking about those moments in your life where things just don't make sense. The things aren't going according to your plan. The story of Joshua is so important because Joshua understood it wasn't the size of his army, it wasn't the logical tactics that he had that would bring him success and prosperity in the promised land. He understood the logic of curveballs. He understood that things don't always make sense, that things don't always go his way. But if he trusts in his coach, if he trusts in his king and his Lord who tells him when to fight, when not to fight, when to walk around the city for 7 times 7 days. It doesn't make any sense. It is the weirdest military tactic. But if you do that and you are strong and you are courageous, that God is going to be with you. That God is going to bring you victory in your life. In closing, we are in preparation for Passion Week and for Holy Week, for this time that we go. And I'm going to be really clear with you. I would love to see our church inviting people who do not know the gospel to come this Sunday. And here's the thing. I think too many of you are waiting for fastballs, and you're almost being like, Lord, okay, you know, I want to bring someone to church. Would you please send someone my way that I could invite to church? And I know your heart, and I know that there's a beauty that you have this inner desire to hit a home run. Like, you're like, please, Lord, send someone my way that I can invite to church, or I could talk the gospel, that I could really invite them. And you're just waiting. And God is like, all right, here's one. And there's a person who comes your way, and you're like, oh, they're out in left field. They're just like going, they're over here. There's no way that I'm ever going to invite them. And so when it comes your way, you're just like, oh, nope, that wasn't for me. And God's like, okay, let's try again. And he throws another person at your way, and you're like, you meet them at the grocery store, and you're like, hey, it's been so long since I've seen you. How's your life? How's things going? And they're like, oh, like, life is really hard. I'm going through a divorce. I'm going through a lot of marital problems, and my kids are struggling at school. And that person's your way, and you're meeting them, and you're like, whoa, that person's got too much baggage to come to church. And it's like, it was great seeing you. I hope everything gets better. I'll be praying for you. Have a good day. And you see, God's like, wait, that one, I literally lofted it at you, and you didn't even try. You're like, God, okay, I'll try again. Who's someone that I could really invite to church? And really, this is the beauty of it, is that as God is throwing these people at your way, the joy is that your form of how you're supposed to approach them is the same, is that you're just supposed to love them. Like, it's not like you have to be flashy and do all these amazing things. Just love them. And see where the Spirit takes you. And you can even just be honest with the Spirit and tell the Spirit, I'm not good with words. I'm not good at making these connections with people. But I want to grow your kingdom. I want to do your will. Lord, would you help me? And this is where the Spirit's going to say, I love helping you. I would love to do this with you. But I need you to submit to me. I need you to let go and let me. I need you to really trust that when you let go and let me, I can do a miracle. I can do something amazing. You see, church, again, this is not a call that we have next service just full to the brim because we go out and we talk to as many people as you want. That's human work. That's the human structures and the human system. I am not really interested in that. What am I interested in is that you have stories where throughout your week you are sensitive to what God is saying to you, and your ears are open, your eyes are open. Who is God wanting into his kingdom? Who is God wanting in his household? And we become better at learning and being sensitive to what God is saying. You see, this is, and I'm going to end it here. This is what it is. Using the baseball analogy, when you're at the plate, it's scary. And I get it. It's really terrifying. I'm a fraidy cat in general. But there's something about when you're going, and if you know what the pitch is, you begin to know like little tells and tips. Like as they have their wind up, you begin to know, oh, that wind up is like this. That's the cadence, and you can learn. Okay, here's it coming. I can start my swing now, and you can start swinging, and you can hit and make that contact. And there are baseball players where they even talk about it. They know before they even see it that it's a home run. They just by the way it feels, and they can feel it, and they feel the game. The form of all of that swing is what you already know. And I think this is like my more pastoral call on you. Too many of you have been training on your form. Too many of you have been just really analyzing, and you've been sitting down there and been like, okay, this is how I'm supposed to share my faith. This is how I'm supposed to have my Bible study. This is how I'm supposed to do all things. And you know, it's like, yeah, you got it. You got it all. You need to go play. Like, you need to go in the game. Like, you need to actually do ministry. And this is what I love about people, because people are like, oh, no, I can't. No, there's no way. Like, leave that to the pastor. That's your job. Like, if anything, I'll bring them to church, and then you preach, and then they come, then they get to know the gospel. Like, that's on you. I can't do it. Okay, let me really get this to you. I do want to preach. I will preach the gospel. I want to preach the gospel all the time. But there's something beautiful about you going to the bat and you making this faith real to you. And to really bring this back to Palm Sunday, really bring this back to the entry of Jesus, the people who are worshiping and saying, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, and if they really were following Jesus, as they see Jesus flipping up the tables, and as they see Jesus, you know, teaching about these various parables, as they see Jesus being tried on trial by both the religious elite as well as Pontius Pilate in the governorship of the Roman Empire, I feel like this. Maybe there were people who are like, Lord, what are you doing? Lord, how can I still follow you? Lord, how can, even despite the fact that I literally see Jesus dying, my whole religious world is crumbling, that all of my hopes and my dreams in Christ are dead on the cross, it's all over. Lord, what are you doing? That in those moments, we learn to trust God. We learn to trust him. And this is where I want to be. I want to be that person that was saying, welcome. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Sees Jesus do his ministry. Sees Jesus dying on the cross. And in my heart, I have a hope that says, God can turn this around. Like, God can do something amazing. God can do a miracle in this. And then 3 days later, on that Sunday, when the women go and they see Jesus, you see, they begin to realize, yeah, I didn't know what he was going to do, even though he told us what he was going to do. I didn't know what he was going to do. But now that I see it, I understand that his ways are miraculous. And then celebration, it's not just a celebration on Palm Sunday where it's welcome Jesus into the city. It's a celebration for his resurrection, that Jesus, you defeated death. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Let's pray. Gracious Father, I pray, Lord, for us that as we even have the inability to pray correctly, because we are so selfish, that we are so wrapped up in our own plans, our own ways, our own desires, Lord, I pray that you, in our weakness, would intercede for us. Father, we are prone to wander. We are prone to sin. I pray, Lord, that as we enter into this Passion Week, Lord, that we would celebrate you for who you are. Lord, it's not about us. It's not about our hopes, our dreams. It's not about our desires. Lord, it's all about you and your plan. Lord, I thank you that your plan, in your infinite grace, Lord, your plan does include us. That you do care about us. You do care about our desires. You care about us more than we can ever imagine. But I pray, Lord, that we would not make this week about us, We would not make Holy Week about what you can do for us. I pray that this week our eyes would be focused on Jesus, on what you have accomplished through your power, through your sacrifice. Father, let this week not be about me. Let it not be about ERCC. Let it be about your Son and only your Son. So, Father, I pray that as we go through this week, Lord, would you send us people our way? Lord, people that we could share the gospel with, that we could share the love of Christ, that you would show us your plan, your will, your ways, and you would use us as your instruments. Father, I pray that there would be people who come to know you this week, who come to surrender their lives to Jesus. Father, I pray that we would experience that kind of prosperity. Lord, I pray that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So, Lord, we love you. We thank you. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so at this time, if you are able, would you please rise and continue with us in worship?
What he did about 2,000 years ago during this week.
Oh,
on this Palm Sunday, I hope you understand, as long as we all grasp, that our Savior is not conventional by any means. That a conventional Savior would have come in and he would have ruled and reigned with an iron scepter and said, "You're all subject under me. You're all under my control, and I rule over all of you. And that's how I rule and I reign over you, is with this iron fist." But praise God that our ruler, our Messiah, our Savior, instead overthrew sin and death by dying on a cross, by being nailed to a tree, hung there like a criminal for us, that his humility, that even though he deserved all the gold and all the crowns and all the silver in the world, that instead he chose a crown of thorns. He chose to be spit on. He chose to be mocked and persecuted, so that you and I could experience a relationship with him. I pray that as we understand the depth of our love that we have in Christ, the love of the Father on us, I pray that as we go out into this world, that we would be courageous, we would be brave, we would trust in him. I truly believe that you will have opportunity to bring people to know Christ, that you will have opportunity to share the love of Jesus with someone, that it's not just my privilege, that it's your privilege, that you have the ability to spread the gospel and share the love and forgiveness of Christ. The question is, are you going to have the bravery to go and take that at bat and swing with all your power, all your might, with all the love you have, trusting that the Lord is the one who's called you there? Let's pray. Gracious Father, I thank you for this church. Lord, I pray you would commission us to go out, to spread the beautiful name of Jesus. Lord, that we would go to our neighbors and say, "The Savior is here. The Savior is here," that he's come riding on a donkey. He's come into the city, and he is here to forgive us of our sins. He is here to free us of the bondage that we're in. Father, I pray that that heart would be on us. Lord, that even when your ways don't make sense to us, even when your plan is higher than our plans, Lord, that we would understand that you use the foolish things of the world to humble the wise. Father, I pray that as we go out into our day-to-day lives, as we go to work, as we meet with our friends, as we meet with our neighbors, Lord, I pray you would give us the courage to share the love of Christ. You would give us the courage to talk about heavenly things, to talk about our relationship with you. And Father, I pray that through that courage, through our submission to you, through our trust in you, Lord, you would bring many people to know who you are. You would bring people to come and repent of their ways and enter into an eternal relationship with you. Father, I pray that as we prepare for Easter, you would show us miracles. You would show us the miracle of sins being forgiven. And Father, I pray that you would humbly use us as tools in that process. Father, I pray that as we have our devotionals and our Good Friday service and our spring fling, as well as our Easter service next Sunday, Father, you would draw in your people. You would draw in those who are far from you, that we would return to you and worship you as God. And now may the Lord bless you and may he keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Thank you, and have a blessed Sunday.